All right, tonight we're going to go into 2 Kings chapter 6, and tonight we're going to be talking about spiritual senses. You know, God has blessed us with physical senses, and we also have spiritual senses. They really parallel our physical senses. We have the sense of taste. Scripture says, taste and see that the Lord is good. We have the sense of smell, and it's a sweet-smelling aroma before the Lord. So there's this spiritual sense. We have hearing. Hear what the Spirit of God says to the church. We have those touch. The Holy Spirit moves, and there's a sense of His touch upon us in our lives. And then the Lord says, open their eyes that they may see. You know, and Isaiah says, I see the Lord. So there are these spiritual aspects to our senses. The problem is that we have different areas that we need to make sure that we examine, that we don't let anything get in the way of our spiritual senses. We live in a world today where we're being bombarded with attacks upon those spiritual senses. And so it's up to us to cultivate, to sow to the things of the Spirit so that we can be able to bring out those times when we want to taste and see that the Lord is good and smell that sweet-smelling aroma of the Lord and hearing what the Spirit is saying. We want to be those people. It's vital that we're those people. And so we got to be on guard. And so let's pray and we'll just get into God's word. Father, we thank you again for Lord, those convictions of the Holy Spirit. Lord, Holy Spirit, we thank you that you come here to convict us. We need that challenge of your conviction, Lord. And we also thank you that in that challenge of turning, that Lord, once we recognize and acknowledge that we come and we find the comfort, Lord, the conviction, the challenge, and the comfort. And so we bless you tonight. We ask that you just take us, Holy Spirit. Lord, reveal to us, show us, Lord, those great and mighty things that we don't understand, we don't know, so that we may know and we may understand and may walk in the light as you were in the light, Lord. And we thank you that your blood comes and cleanses us of all sin. Thank you, Father. Thank you for forgiveness of our sins. In Jesus' name, amen. It's interesting in this scripture that and Jesus is speaking to the religious leaders, and he chides them because they can't discern the weather. You can look at the weather, but you can't discern the signs of the times. And there's a spiritual understanding of seeing and what's going on around you, because that was speaking of his coming, and yet they couldn't see it. And then we're coming up next week, as we're coming into this Sunday, Palm Sunday, the spiritual senses that were going on. Hosanna, Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest. Baruch Abba Hashem Adonai. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And there was this sense that they were there. But then what happened a week later? Crucify him. Crucify him. There was something happening that there was a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. And there was no move of the Spirit. And that spiritual senses were dull and absent. It's interesting how the Bible begins with two people whose spiritual senses were perfect in the beginning. Adam and Eve walked with God. They talked with God. Two elements that reflect healthy spiritual senses. They were walking and talking with God. But when sin entered in, something happened and they were no longer walking and talking with God. Matter of fact, you know the story. They were hiding from him. They had quit seeking him. They had drifted away. Hebrews talks about that. Be on guard lest you drift away. But it was God who initiated the first contact back. Just as it is with us, it's God who initiated it. You know, there used to be an old bumper sticker. I found it, but it wasn't that he found, you know, I wasn't looking for him. He was looking for me. Adam, where are you? Where are you? And the reason that God asked that wasn't because that God didn't know where Adam was. God knew perfectly where Adam was. It was Adam who didn't realize where he was. His spiritual senses had died. He was no longer aware of the presence of God. There are times that you and I go through that it just seems like, Lord, where are you? I start looking around real carefully. Lord, I just, something in here is not right. And I want to be in that place, the perfect peace of God that rules and guards my heart. In Luke 19:10, Jesus says that he came to seek and to save that which was lost. He came to restore the thing that Adam had lost. He came to restore that intimate relationship with the Father, restore those spiritual senses where we once again could be able to hear and see what the Holy Spirit is saying to the church. And Jesus said, I came to give you life and it more abundantly. Well, we love those scriptures, you know. We need to tie things together, though. And then he told Nicodemus, you must be born again. Oh, I love that. I love that portion of scripture. So first we come to that place. First you must believe and receive him as your Savior. And then you must repent of your sins. This is where the things begin to take place. My eyes are open. My spiritual senses are heightened again. Where I'm hearing and I'm seeing and my spiritual senses are restored. But it just doesn't happen and stay in that one place. We have a responsibility in all this. We must daily pick up our cross and deny ourselves, follow him. That means that we have to be crucifying the things of the flesh. This is a part of that a lot of Christians have trouble with. Mortify, crucify, put down. But yet at the same time, you know, they indulge and we indulge. And this is where we have to be careful, because as we give in to the flesh, we actually dull the senses of the Spirit. It's not God's fault, it's my fault. I think in Spanish, is it mi culpa, my fault? Is that right? Yes? Mi culpa. It's my fault. I did it. It wasn't anybody else's fault. I'm the one. So we have to come in daily and we need to refresh ourselves in the Spirit daily, crucifying the flesh, sowing to the Spirit. I'm gonna challenge you. How many of you have a time of devotion in the morning? You know, if you don't, this is a vital portion of your cultivating the things of the Spirit to be able to hear what the Spirit of God is saying throughout the day, because God uses his word to speak to us. Acts 2:42 says, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, fellowship, and the breaking of bread and in prayer. These people were spiritual. They were spiritually tuned in. Notice where they were. They were in the Word. They were in fellowship. They had times where they sat down and ate together. They spent time in prayer with the Lord and with each other. There's corporate prayer and there's individual prayer. Sowing to the things of the Spirit that Galatians 6:8 says. You know, I just would encourage you. I'm up here to be a messenger. I'm here to challenge you. Prayer meetings should be full. Prayer rooms should be full. Every time there's a prayer, corporate prayer was a part of the early church. It was a part of each individual, but corporate prayer was something that they had to squeeze in room because there were so many people in there. Because it was the power of God coming down and filling the rooms. We know in the second chapter of Acts, we have them. They're filled in that room, and then they were filled in the Spirit. This is where the power, we want to find, the church will not move forward unless it's on its knees, it's been said. So to the Spirit. So turn to 2 Kings chapter 6, and we're going to see a little bit of how God desires that we have spiritual eyes and ears to hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to each of us. 2 Kings chapter 6. And the sons of the prophets said to Elisha, see how the place where we dwell with you is too small for us. Please let us go to the Jordan. Let every man take a beam from here, from there, and let us make a place where we may dwell. So he said, go. Then one said, please consent to go with your servants. And he said, I will go. So he went with them. And when they came to Jordan, they cut down trees. But as one was cutting down a tree, the iron axe head fell into the water. And he cried out and said, alas, master, for it was borrowed. So the man of God said, where did it fall? And he showed him the place. So he cut off a stick, threw it in there, and he made the iron float. Therefore, he said, pick it up for yourself. This is God provides, but then we need to pick it up. God makes a way. He's given us everything that pertains to life and godliness in Christ Jesus. Sorry for us to reach out and grab it and pick it up, and we'll go with it. And he says, so he reached out his hand and took it. Now, the sons of the prophets, basically, it was a school for prophets. And they would come there and they would, you know, have a prophet like Elisha come and they would instruct them, you know, the ways of hearing. Again, being sensitive to hear what the Spirit of God is saying and being also one who speaks the Word of God, taking the Word of God, having the Rhema of God, the moment that he speaks, being able to be sensitive to hear that. And so these prophets had grown out of their facility. What a great thing. You know, we just praise God. Lord, that this school of prophets in Calvary Chapel, Santa Maria, be like this. That we would grow to such a degree that we go, well, this place is too small. Isn't that cool? I love it. So let it be. So when Elisha shows up, you know, they tell him, hey, you know, we need a bigger place. And they ask if they could go down to the Jordan and build a new facility down there. So Elisha says, yeah, go ahead, sounds good. So they say, well, will you come with us? You know, we really need the, because you really represent the presence of God. And so he goes, okay, I'll go with you. And so he goes with them. And they're cutting down the timber and they're building this thing. And as they're doing this, one of the men's axe head flies off his axe and it goes in the river. And he comes back to Elisha and says, hey, Elisha, you know, I borrowed this axe. I don't own it. And it's something, it's a tool, it's too expensive. And, you know, it'd be like, you know, you having, a nice big saw, you know, that's cost you maybe $1,000, you know, and you'd go out and you'd, oop, I blew the motor up. You know, it was a way he was making his living and he borrowed it. So he was worried how he was going to pay for it. So Elisha asked where it flew off. And he says, okay, we'll go over here. And he goes over and he cuts a branch off and he throws it in the water. And all at once, this axe head comes floating to the surface. It's interesting. You know, as we serve the Lord, in all the years that I've walked with the Lord, there's times that Paul said that he says, I've known plenty and I've known poverty, but I've known to be content in all things. It seems like sometimes as you walk with the Lord, you serve the Lord, it seems like everything's a complete loss. You go through a portion of your life and it's like, what happened? You know, well, don't confess that, brother. You know. Wait a minute. I'm a believer. I love the Lord. I'm in surrender. I'm not in sin. And yet my whole life is falling apart around me. You know, God has a way to teach us, doesn't he? God has a way to redeem even the things that seemingly are lost. Look at yourself. I was seemingly lost, and yet now I'm found. God has a way to do it that goes beyond anything that we could ever think. First Corinthians chapter 12, Paul, he speaks about the spiritual gifts, and he talks about the word of knowledge, and this is what we're going to look here, is that it's basically telling something that somebody has been, you know, it hasn't been revealed to you. And so he says here in chapter 6, verse 8, and now the king of Syria was making war against Israel. And he consulted with his servants, saying, my camp will be in such and such a place. And the man of God sent to the king of Israel, saying, beware that you do not pass this place, for the Syrians are coming down there. And then the king of Israel sent someone to the place where the man of God had told him. Thus he warned him, and he was watchful there, not just once or twice. Therefore, the heart of the king of Syria was greatly troubled by this thing. And he called his servant and said to him, will you not show me which of us is for the king of Israel? And one of his servants says, none, my lord, O king, but Elisha, the prophet who is in Israel, tells the king of Israel the words that you speak in your bedroom. Interesting thing. Every time the Syrians tried to lay a trap for Israel, Elisha's there warning them, hey, get ready, they're going to come around through the canyon there. And it got so bad that the king of Syria thought he had a spy in his troops. And one of his servants says, hey, king, there's a prophet over there in Israel that God speaks to and warns him about any move that you're about to make and anything that you are about to say, even down into your bedroom. So after hearing this, the king figures, you know what? The only way that we're going to get victory then is to silence the one who's exposing our plans, our secrets. So he sends out this great army to arrest Elijah, just like it had happened to Elijah. So he said, go and see where he is, that I may send and greet him. And it was told him, saying, surely he is in Dothan. Therefore, he sent horses and chariots and a great army there, and they came by night and surrounded the city. And when the servant of the man of God arose early and went out, there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. And his servant said to him, "Alas, my master, what shall we do?" So he answered, "Do not fear." This is confidence in God. This is somebody that has his eyes on right. He's seeing things, you know. He's seeing spiritual things. I love it when I get around somebody that has spiritual eyes to see what's going on. You know, they see past this physical and they see into the spiritual realm. Do you know what time it is? You know, do you look around? Do you see the season that we're in? Look up, for your redemption draws nigh. Can you see it? Look. Allow the Lord. Speak to the Lord. Ask the Lord that we may see those things. Do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them. Isn't that great? And Elisha prayed and said, "Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see." Then the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. So when the Syrians came down to him, Elisha prayed to the Lord and said, "Strike this people, I pray, with blindness." One moment they're seeing, and the next minute there's going to be blindness. And he struck them with blindness according to the word of Elisha. But isn't that always seem like the case? The moment we get our eyes on our circumstances, it seems like we're outnumbered. Seems like, you know, we're surrounded. There's no way out. And that's when it's good to be close to fellow believers. That's when it's good to be in a prayer meeting. That's when it's good to be in a Bible study. It's good to have a fellow believer who can come alongside you. Someone that's not surrounded by the same circumstances that you're surrounded with. Someone that can see through the forest, through the trees. Because sometimes it's so overwhelming, you can't even see. You're going, "What? And it just seems like there's no way out of this." But coming alongside a fellow believer and knowing that they've come and they are spiritually experienced, they may be able to see and hear what you're not able to see or hear. And you can say, "Lord, open his eyes. Open his eyes." Paul says this to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3 and 4. He says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in trouble with the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted by God." Those moments are vital. You've got victory, you've seen, you know, you've heard, you've tasted, you've seen, and now there's somebody else. We don't go through these trials just because the Lord is doing it so we'll grow up. He wants us to grow up, but he does it many times because he knows the end from the beginning. He knows that you're going to be in contact with somebody else's life who's just going to be devastated, and they can't see where they're at when they're in the middle of it. And then you've been comforted by God because he's shown you and you've heard from him and he's comforted you in the word. This is, I believe, a model prayer for those that come to you. It's a prayer that we all need. We're in the middle of some difficult situation, isn't it? Open our eyes, Lord, that we may see. I don't understand, Lord. How many times have you done that in your life as a Christian? You've gone, "I don't understand. Lord, I've done everything, Lord, and I'm here before you, and I'm humbled, and I'm broken, and I don't understand." And then someone comes alongside and gives you a word. Or the Holy Spirit gives you a word. See, it's God's desire that we have spiritual eyes to see. See the spiritual things that he's doing. Hear the spiritual things that he's saying, what the Holy Spirit is saying to the church. We are the church of the last days. We don't want to be lulled to sleep by the things of this world and the cares of this world and those sins that so easily beset us, those things that can trip us up. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. It's mentioned 6 times in the book of Revelation. Colossians says this, "Set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth." I think that should be on everybody's bumper sticker or in their car Get up in the morning, set your mind on the things above, not on the things of the earth. It's too easy. Our flesh gives in too much. I love this in the New Living Translation. When Jesus is there, so that the scriptures might be fooled, when they see what I do, they will learn nothing. Because their eyes and their ears are dull. When they hear what I say, they will not understand. Otherwise, they will turn to me and be forgiven. I love that because that's talking about having eyes to see and ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to an individual. But I want you to notice how Elisha, he sees the greatness of God in the midst of his circumstances. Don't be afraid. Don't fear. For those who are with us are more than those who are with them. Isn't that great? Doesn't that sound like something we know in the New Testament? We're going to find that all the way. As you study the Word of God, there are portions that Paul quotes from, Peter quotes from, Mark quotes from, everything. They'll pull it out of the Old Testament. That's why it's vital that we have the whole counsel of the Word of God. Knowing exactly where it is in the Old Testament is really important to where we can show it in the New, especially if you're speaking to a Jew. If you know what the New Testament is, you've got to have that application of where it ties in the Old Testament. You know, and really in the law. If you go to the law, you can find it in the first five books of the law. But notice how he looks at the greatness of God. But here he says to John, 1 John, he says to the Holy Spirit, says to us in chapter 4, verse 4, you are of God, little children, and overcome them, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Looking around you, those that, you know, the enemy may be there, but those that are with us are greater than those out there that are against us. And then on the inside, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Hey, that's a winning combination. We have victory on the outside, but we also have power for victory on the inside. And so as they're there, Gehazi, his servant, is there, and he prays for him. Opened his eyes, and he looked around, and when he did, he could see these angels and chariots of fire ready to attack. Yeah, I like that. I mean, you're going through a trial, and you look around, and the Lord says, here, open your eyes. And you look around and you see up and around the hills of Santa Maria and you see these chariots of fire there for you, ready to come to your aid. And so Elisha prays that they would be blinded, and they were. And so they were ready to attack, but Elisha, he goes, you know, no, let's wait a minute. Let's blind them. God has another plan. Now, there's two illustrations here, and one is of someone who has spiritual eyes and ears, and they're attentive to the things of God. And then there's another one. There's the one who isn't. And so here's the struggle of that struggle between the flesh and the spirit, of staying in the spirit. And he says, now, Elisha said to them in verse 19, this is not the way, nor the city. This is the city. Follow me, and I will bring you to the man whom you seek. Now, this is interesting because, you know, this is the man they were seeking. So, but he led them to Samaria. So it was when they had come to Samaria that Elisha said, Lord, open the eyes of these men that they may see. And the Lord opened their eyes, and they saw, and there they were inside Samaria. The second time that Elisha, he says, to open their eyes of someone. And so, these Assyrians there, they didn't know it was Elisha after they'd been struck by being blind. And Elisha tells them, you know, hey, you know, I'll take you to the man that you're seeking. And so they go along and they're there in Samaria and they get in Samaria. And as they're in Samaria, Elisha prays to open their eyes, and they open their eyes, and standing in front of them is Elisha. The very man, the one that they were seeking, he told them that he would take him to the man they were seeking, and he did. He just didn't tell him he was the one. You know, I got to thinking about Paul when he's talking to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 2:14. But the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. Here's a spiritual man. Here's a carnal man. They didn't receive, and so now they're blind. But now he says, open their eyes, and now they can see. And so there's this spiritual battle going on here. Verse 21, now, when the king of Israel saw them, he said to Elisha, my father, shall I kill them? Shall I kill them? But he answered, you shall not kill them. Would you kill those whom you have taken captive with your sword and your bow? Set food and water before them, that they may eat and drink and go to their master. Then he prepared a great feast for them, and after they ate and drank, he sent them away, and they went to their master. So the bands of Syrian raiders came no more into the land of Israel. The king of Syria, Ben-Hadad, had been attacking Israel for quite some time, and now, all at once, here's his army inside the walls of Samaria, and the king of Israel comes out. He's terrified. He's alarmed. He's going, oh, no, Elijah, what should I do? Should I kill him? And Elisha said, no. Did you kill the captives that you've taken in battle, you know? Instead, feed them and set them free, send them home. And I found this quote. It's been said that the greatest avenue to peace is to show peace. Doesn't that sound like something Jesus said to us? And to do good to those who want to harm you. You know, good, do good to the evil, those who do evil to you. And so for a time there was peace, there was no more raids. Seemed like everything was good, but that doesn't last long. It says, and it happened after this that Ben-Hadad, king of Syria, gathered all his army and went up and besieged Samaria. And there was a great famine in Samaria. And indeed they besieged it until a donkey's head was sold for 80 shekels of silver and 1/4 of a cob of dove droppings for 5 shekels of silver. Then as the king of Israel was passing by on a wall, a woman cried out to him, saying, help my lord, O king. And he said, if the Lord, this is Yahweh, does not help you, where can I find help for you? From the threshing floor or from the wine press? Then the king said to her, what is troubling you? And she answered, this woman said to me, give your son that we may eat him today, and we will eat my son tomorrow. So we boiled my son and ate him. And I said to her, on the next day, give your son that we may eat him. But she had hidden her son. They have gone to a place that was so far down that they couldn't look up to see down. They were so far lost. Whenever they would besiege a city in those days, they would cut off the water supply, food supply. And this siege had gotten so bad that they had resorted to cannibalism. And these two women, their dispute came up between them because one of the women, they both agreed to eat their boys. So the first lady, that she goes and they eat her son, they boil her son, and the next day she went to the other lady to have her son, and she hit him, and so they ended up in this fight, and they cry out to the king. I find it interesting because back in Deuteronomy chapter 8, 28, God warned them of what would happen if they departed from him. And if they followed other gods, and if they followed into the pagan hands of pagan idols, it's just a fulfillment of the warning. Deuteronomy 28, verse 53, you shall eat the fruit of your own body, the flesh of your sons and your daughters, whom the Lord your God has given you. In the siege and the desperate straits in which your enemy shall distress you, the sensitiveness and the very refined man among you will be hostile towards his brother and toward the wife of his bosom and toward the rest of his children whom he leaves behind, so that he will not give any of them the flesh of his children whom he will eat, because he has nothing left in the siege and desperate straits in which your enemy shall distress you at all your gates. God warned them. They didn't listen. Spiritual eyes and spiritual ears. So now here comes the king. He blames God for this tragedy. You know, why, God? Why have you caused this to happen to us in our nation? Oh, God, we're a godly nation. No, we have stepped away from our God. The church needs to come and be sanctified and holy and set apart before the Lord. We can't blame God. God's there. It's us who have moved, not God. It's not his fault. if we refuse to listen. It's not his fault if we refuse and we turn a blind eye. It's not his fault. Now it happened in verse 30, when the king heard the words of the woman, that he tore his clothes, and as he passed by on the wall, the people looked, and there underneath he had sackcloth on his body. Then he said, God, do so to me and more also, if the head of Elisha, the son of Shaphat, remains on him today. Oh, he was upset. But Elisha was sitting in his house. His peace. And the elders were sitting with him, and the king sent a man ahead of him. But before the messenger came to him, he said to the elders, do you see how this son of a murderer has sent someone to take away my head? Look, when the messenger comes, shut the door and hold him fast at the door. Is not the sound of his master's feet behind him? And while he was still talking, there was the messenger coming down to him. And then the king said, surely this calamity is from the Lord. Why should I wait for the Lord any longer? Wow, what a big mistake. This is from the Lord, you better wait a little longer. Remember, it was Elisha who had the Syrian set free, previous verses. Let him go home. Now they're under siege. Samaria's under siege. As the king sat there in his sackcloth and mourning, he blamed Elisha for everything that was coming down. He was blaming everything that was happening to them. And he made an oath that he would kill him before the end of the day. Now, whose fault was it that they were in the situation they were in? It was theirs. They were the ones who had disobeyed. They were the ones who had followed after the foreign gods and the pagan gods. They were the ones who refused to listen to God. Isn't it interesting that the guilty always blame the innocent to find their way out? They always take the innocent and blame them. They always take the innocent and they crucify them as they did to our Lord. It's always the innocent who suffer because of the guilty. It's critical that we learn how to cultivate a spiritual life, a spiritual eyes, taste, smell, hear, and see. So Elisha tells Gehazi, they're coming, but don't let them in. And then there they were. Spiritual eyes and ears always will be there to assure us that greater are those who are with us than those who are with them. And greater is he that is in us than he is in the world. Are you here tonight and you feel like you're surrounded? Are you here tonight and it seems like there's no way out? My prayer is, Lord, open their eyes that they may see Jesus. Lord, open their eyes to see that Jesus is the way out of the impossible situation that they're in. To understand that our God is the God of the impossible. Our God is able to do above anything we could ever think or imagine. He's able to make a way where there is no way. I stand here tonight as a testament that God is able to make a way where there is no way. He's able. If you're here tonight and you need prayer, if you're here tonight and you just want to come and just allow a moment to just say, hey, there are going to be others up here and we're going to have some pastors, elders that will be able, would love to pray for you, but I have one last verse I want to share with you. Seems like this doorway of the impossible is there. And Jesus said this concerning himself, I am the door, the great I am. I am the door in John 10:9. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. Father, tonight I just want to ask that, Lord, there are those places in our times that, Lord, we need to taste and see that the Lord is good. Lord, we need to sense you, but Lord, we want to have ears to hear what you are saying to us. And if there is a circumstance, if there's a situation here tonight, Lord, that is blocking us from being able to come in before you and sense you, Lord, it's my fault, mi culpa, it's me. I confess my sin before you, Lord. I open up my heart and just say, Lord, I am the one. Lord, I don't want to point my finger at anybody else. Lord, I don't want to be like Peter and John, and Jesus says, what's that have to do with you? You follow me. I want to be the one that, Lord, comes and says, first of all, Lord, open my eyes that I may see. Touch my deaf ears, Lord. Touch my deaf ears that I may hear what the Spirit of God is saying. Lord, if there's anyone here tonight, Lord, that needs that touch, Lord, I just want to take a moment and just even pray from here, Lord, to reach out for them. And Lord, if they're here, Lord, give them the courage to just raise their hand. And Lord, I'd love to pray for them. If you're here and you are, I'd love to pray for you. Yes, that hand, those hands, any other hands. Jesus, Lord, it's not to a man that they are reaching out to, it's to you. Lord, so we come and we ask God, open our eyes that we may see. Open their eyes as Gehazi, Lord, as Elisha would pray, I pray, open their eyes that they may see the greater are those who are with us than those who are against us. And greater is he that is in us than he who is in the world, Lord. We ask God that you would just pour into us tonight by your Spirit and by your love. In Jesus' name, amen.